Okay, welcome to my Folio 2 iterative progression for IOL. Today I'm mostly going to be talking about my process for my iterations involving my animations for the past 12 weeks, well, 6 weeks rather. My project intention, just a quick reiteration. So my goal was, after extensive research, my intent for this project is to combine both the Eastern and Western animation techniques and directorial methods to produce dynamic, fluid, and exciting action scenes. These scenes were iterated on throughout iOS with a consistent stream of iteration and consultation, producing new cycles of iteration. The reason for this was my Studio 3 work was somewhat of a homage to Japanese animation, and as a Western animator, I was kind of using iOS and I guess Studio 3 as a whole as a means of combining these influences to create a film that serves the purpose of homaging 90s and late 80s Japanese anime with traditional techniques in Western animation. So the aim of my iOS iterations in this aspect is to experiment with character movement and its relationship with the camera. How does this relationship enhance movement, impact weight, spectacle, etc.? I'm going to go a bit deeper into related works this time around. This will be extended upon in my PDF, but for the sake of the presentation, I just want to start with my base inspiration for this task, which were the GDC talks of Marielle Cartwright, who is the animator for Skullgirls and Indivisible. This gave me a great basis for the middle ground of Eastern Western animation because Skullgirl's characters are noticeably bouncy and elastic, reminiscent of Tex Avery, Chuck Jones, early animation. Even the designs, they kind of fluctuate between looking very anime and an example of the character on the left, kind of more Fleischer, kind of early animation influence looking. And so this combination of influences is really interesting to me. I think was a good basis for me to, you know, moving forward, kind of finding that middle ground, the homage of anime mixed with my kind of more Western stylings. Just quickly to run through the examples of the GDC talks and also the live animation demo that she did. If we scroll here through here, we can kind of see her talking about animation fundamentals, whether it's Western or Eastern. This kind of stuff is the backbone of animation, but she kind of talks about how she uses it in limited frames and the spacing that is more relevant and commonly found in Japanese animation. So it's kind of interesting to see her approach in Skullgirls. These examples of her inspiration, which is ironically kind of similar inspiration to mine, and Smears in particular, are more Eastern styled and very much like the basis of what I was starting off in mind when I was creating these animations for my film and also iterating in IOL, obviously. The live animation demo is just kind of like a thorough retelling of her usual approach to animating. This was kind of a good just reference point for me, and anytime I had fundamental issues in terms of strikes or kicks, it's like, okay, well, with a kick I probably want to smear it because it's like a circular movement and that'll create like a nice sense of flow, but with a jab or a punch I kind of want that overextended motion and then pop the hand back in. That kind of stuff was really helpful in the long run for me. Just moving forward again to my second related work, which is Arc System Works, which is primarily a fighting game game studio. They used to make 2D fighting games with beautiful 2D animation and sprite work, but since then they've moved into 3D fighting games, but the animation is still very much fundamentally using the aspects of 2D, breaking the body, using either replacement models or just stretching out and kind of exaggerating those models to recreate the stretch and squash in 2D. And the thing that I've really used when it comes to their influence, though, is the liberal use of 3D space when utilizing the camera in relation to the characters. The camera is primarily used to highlight the expressions and turn simple movements and standard attacks into dynamic spectacles of movement and impact. I've got some examples of how this stuff has inspired what I've been doing this semester. I think the important thing to note here is that although they use this method, I'll just show both examples because they might be a bit overwhelming, but they're both really good examples of zooms. That one just there for Guilty Gear, that was kind of the effect I was trying to create in my animations, the pans and the sharp zooms and the cuts. This stuff's being done in 3D, so it's a different kind of task of taking a 3D camera and moving it around and having that kind of flexibility, whereas I'm drawing them and kind of having to understand how a character rotates in a 3D space, which is ironically like more of a fun challenge for me that I enjoyed doing. But this is definitely where the inspiration for these kind of shots came, and the excitement or motivation of trying to recreate this stuff in 2D, which has been done before, but it was a new challenge for me. Just moving forward again, if this will stop playing. More fundamental stuff I found in the later half of my iterations that I kind of went back to, I guess, what I'd consider one of the masters of Western animation, James Baxter, and kind of looked at his work of implementing 2D animated characters in a simulated 3D space, especially the kick animation, which I'll show later, which is very much 2D characters rotating and zooming in and out of a 3D space. A lot of his stuff, looking at it, helped me really understand where I was having issues with weight and balance and why my movement wasn't translating well. His tutorial on weight and balance explained a host of issues I was having, where to start the key poses and how quickly to get into the action. I have a bad habit of thinking frame to frame rather than key pose to key pose, and these videos kind of disrupted that approach in a positive way. If we look at these examples, this in particular was a tutorial that was very helpful to me, where he talks about, depending on how quickly you want a character to move and how quickly you want them to pass through the frames, you need to start them leaning on their leg and balanced in a certain way in order to best suit that movement. I was often too preoccupied with anticipation and how that movement was going to start before it got to the key poses, whereas watching this kind of helped me really understand that it's that balance and not so much the anticipation. The anticipation helps the impression of movement, but it's that balance at the beginning that really sells the beginning to end flow. And just a good example of 3D, 2D over 3D movement is this Sinbad pencil test, which is intimidating, but also a really good resource for zooming in and out with a character. And right at the end, it's that up close zoom to really show off the sense of expression, which was something that I tried to emulate in my film at key moments. It's annoying how it keeps doing that. Just moving forward again to the final related work that came in quite recently, in the last 6 weeks, was while I was working, I was watching Ghost in the Shell in the background, just because it's a particularly good film to have on in terms of just influencing the way you draw and holding yourself to a standard in terms of anatomy and camera shots and just how you want shot-to-shot sequential art to flow. But the scene in particular that influenced a lot of the later stuff in my film was the chase scene. The animation in this scene is interesting because one of the characters is invisible, and so the sense of impact and force is relayed entirely by camera shots and the other characters' reactions. This is achieved by using techniques like showing close-ups of limbs twisting or distorting with traditional fundamentals like anticipation and exaggeration, stretch and squash, wide shots showing the scale of movement and action, and the practical effect of water, which this movie does a lot, and I think it's really great in expressing what is happening and the weight and speed of which things are happening without, in this sense, having another character to relay that information. Another big thing was the finalization of this scene. It concludes in the infamous anime rule of threes replay, in which the final attack is replayed three times. to show a sense of conclusion. And if I go into this scene, I'll just skip forward to the climactic part of the fight, which illustrates everything I was talking about. There's a wide shot, and pretty soon we're going to see that go into a close-up. The character's arm moving forward and snapping back shows the anticipation. There's the wide shot and the water helping sell the movement and speed. Once again, anticipation, exaggeration. And here comes our rule of three camera shot. One, two, three. So that stuff really gave me good ground for like, okay, that would be a cool way to complete the final like action shot of my film and give a sense of climax to it. So just before I go into my iteration examples, just upon reflection of the course in the 12 weeks of IOL, I think the cycle of iteration and feedback has allowed me to experiment with key scenes in my Studio 3 animation. As a result, these animations are the best examples of my overall semester goals, which were achieving dynamic animated scenes through liberal use of camera methods, editing techniques, and approaches found in both Eastern and Western animation, as I've just documented in my related works. The two scenes in particular, I think, that have really stood out thanks to this approach are the armor reveal that I talked about in my last presentation, with the arm coming up from the ground and revealing the robotic arm underneath, and the kick attack, which was the primary focus of what I worked on in the last 6 weeks. Probably the most complicated scene I've ever animated. It's still a work in process, to be completely honest, something I think that I can still make look more dynamic and make it more grand, for lack of a better term. But I am happy with the progress I've made. The initial idea was kind of static, and it seemed dynamic when I first came up with it, but looking back, and I'm sure as we'll see in the iterative video that I'll click on after this, it really has grown to be kind of almost, I guess, what I'd consider a boring-looking shot to now something much more interesting. So these iterative cycles have been really good in pushing my skills and challenging myself to become a better animator. And as a result, the scenes that I've been working on, not only prominent pieces of my film, but also a showreel moving forward. I think these are good examples of showcasing what I can do as an animator. So now I'll just run through my iterations for the semester.
Thank you. Hit this.